Welcome to Whole CEO with Lisa G. I'm the best-selling author of the Boss Weight Loss. I'm bringing you the top tips to be unstoppable. This is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to actually pull up a chair with today's top experts in mindset, weight loss, business, and more. Learn our top tips so that you can have more energy, be fit and resilient, feel unstoppable, unshakable, and unbreakable. After being a consulting actuary to Fortune 100 companies, he built the world's largest coaching business, becoming number one on Google for life coaching. He believes the tough conversations we avoid are our doorways to confidence, success, and even love in both work and in life. He coaches high-performing entrepreneurs, executives, and teams, and even prison inmates to amazing results and connection, one conversation at a time. Please welcome to the podcast, David Wood.
Woo! Thank you.
You're welcome. I'm so happy to have you here. Let's jump into the content. I love your stuff. So I want to know the difference between commitment and attachment, and what does commitment really look like?
Oh, that's a good one. Commitment is huge. You know, get a handle on commitment, it can change your life. I had a session today with a client who has a goal of bringing in $2.5 million in this year. And I looked at the self-coaching form because I always have my clients fill in, you know, spend 5 or 10 minutes of prep before our session so I know what's up for them and where they're challenged and what they want to work on. And I looked at her actions, like what she'd achieved and accomplished in the last 2 weeks. And I said, do these look like the actions of someone committed to bringing in $2.5 million? And I'm not giving you a hard time. It's just, it looks like you've done stuff and you've done more than the average population, but does it look like the actions of someone committed to that goal? And we got right into it. Turns out not. She's like, no, it's not. It's like, okay, great. Let's look at it. Why is that? And it turned out she doesn't think it's possible. That's why she hasn't committed.
Wow, that holds us back, right? That belief.
Yeah. If you don't think it's possible, it's not really going to work. Then of course, part of you is pulling you back. So she was not committed.
Right.
And then go ahead.
No, I agree. I know only from firsthand experience that we are our own worst enemies when we don't believe it's possible because we failed before.
Yeah. And so that's a whole other topic, which we might get into about generating possibility. But then because I'm acting now, and if anyone's watching the video, you'll see I got a background at King Kong because
so cool.
I did an audition for a movie they're making about the guy who made King Kong, and I wanted to stand out. So I got King Kong in the background. It's fun. But because everything's acting now for me and I see everything in an acting lens, I brought up an example of me as an actor. I am not committed to being an A-list celebrity. That's not my commitment. I am doing more than most actors, I think, are doing. I moved to Los Angeles and I'm training really hard and I'm submitting to maybe 150 things every week. Wow. And I just got an agent and I'm doing it. But if I was truly committed to breaking through and being a major star, there's so much more I could do. I could be, you know, inviting managers and agents to be on my podcast and networking and building relationships and reading. I could have read 20 more books this last year on acting. I read like 2.
Yeah.
So nothing wrong, no shame, but there's a difference between actually committed to something, which means I'm going to do everything I can to make that happen. And where a lot of us fall down is we get attached to the outcome. So it's like, I don't want to commit to that because then I'll be so upset if it doesn't happen.
Yeah.
And I got this from Landmark Education, a wonderful training company, that you can break those apart. They don't have to coexist in the same way. You can actually be committed to something, like say Martin Luther King committed to ending slavery, Yeah. I don't know if he was attached to that outcome or not. But you can be committed without attached. So I'm living the life of an actor and I'm like auditioning and I'm cranking it, whatever. I actually have no, I'm committed to being successful, but yeah. I have no attachment to whether or not that happens. I'm playing the game. And if the rewards come in, that'll be great. But I'm doing a gig tonight. I'm going to be playing a game show contestant and one of them is a criminal and they've got to work out who the criminal is.
Well, that sounds super fun, but I love the differentiation between commitment and attachment. And I find myself that I am happier when I learn to detach from outcomes and still perform my best effort. And I know we did talk a little bit about self-sabotage when you don't have that self-belief. Is that another topic you want to dive into?
Self-sabotage? Maybe. I had something else about... But still on the commitment and the attachment thing, if you're attached to it, let's suppose you want someone to work for you. You're a CEO and you want to recruit someone and they haven't said yes. They've said no two or three times. You could be, if you're attached to the outcome, you might end up being a real jerk with how you go about it because you're giving them no space to say no. But if you're committed, then you might show up in a charming way and say, hey, I'm not going anywhere. You can keep saying no, but I just know you're going to have a great time working for us. And so just don't be surprised if I ask you again. You can, you see the difference in the energy.
Yeah, if you're not attached. I love it. I think in your business life, this is everything, but in your personal life too, because also sometimes we get attached to other people doing things a certain way. We think that they're supposed to do them. And that's like a deal breaker sometimes in relationships when people are attached to you being just like them or a certain outcome.
Yes. Yeah. Attachment can really hurt us. But if you're free, you see, people have one or the other. They're like, it has to happen. I'm going to make it happen. Or, all right, okay, I give up. But what if you could do both? There's a story about Mark Twain going up a river in a boat. And wherever they got to where there were rocks, they'd pick up the little boat and they'd carry it over the rocks. And then they'd eventually get to a wall. They had to leave the boat and they'd climb.
Yeah.
Eventually, they'd get to some cliff, maybe a waterfall. They're not sure if they could actually do it. So they'd take their caps and they would throw their caps over the wall of rocks.
Yeah.
Because now they had to.
That's commitment. I love that commitment. I love that commitment of just...
Yeah. I don't know how I'm going to do it.
Jump right in.
It doesn't matter yet. I'm committed. And it's very attractive. If you're a leader of any kind, you could be a parent, you could be a partner, you could be a CEO. It's very attractive. Someone who's absolutely committed and yet not attached. You can have more fun with it. Let's play the game. You can't control the wind, but you can control how you set your sails.
I love that saying. It is so true that we put ourselves in so much pain in this world when we're trying to control things that are out of our control. And if we can control the controllables, detach from the outcome, believe that it's possible. Do you want to dive any deeper into self-belief and how we can stop from holding ourselves back? Because let's say we failed before. I know as an entrepreneur, for example. Okay, yeah, that's happened. I feel like just keep lobbing stuff out there and learning from the failures. But how can we still keep 100% believing in ourselves despite the fact that not everything you lob out there is going to work?
Yeah. Well, let's talk about possibility and then self-sabotage because I like it. It's a huge topic. And I've been self-sabotaging recently, so it's timely. So generating possibility is a skill. It's a muscle that can be exercised. And Landmark Education, again, is wonderful for this. They have a distinction of being unstoppable.
Right.
And, you know, we often just shut down and go, oh, that can't happen. That's not possible. Richard Branson's not going to write the foreword to my book. There's no point even asking. But you can actually, even with a piece of paper, sit down or with your coach, you can generate it. With this client today, she said, I don't think it's really possible I could generate that amount of money. And I said, well, let's take a look at it. And we did a little bit of, and just off the top of my head, I said, if you pick a problem that your target market has and you come up with a, let's say you create a 4-week course for those people to solve a problem that they really have. And then you work out a sales page or an offer that is compelling that has people want to do it.
Right.
Now you got two things under your belt. You've got the problem that you're solving and an offer that they want to say yes to. All right. The third step would be that you do a course and get raving results. People want to rave about, wow, this was amazing. You do those three things and now you're off to the races. I can see 2.5 million being a real possibility. Maybe it doesn't take a year. Maybe it takes you three. But if you have those three things, you can now get alliances with other people who are going to want to promote your stuff because it sells and it does really well. And then people start telling their friends. If you don't have these three things, 2.5 million is probably not going to happen. And I said to her, you start to see some possibility here? And she's like, yes. Now, I just didn't have all those stepping stones, but I can see I can take them on one by one and solve each one, and that'll get me there. So with Richard Branson, this is from my life. I wanted him to write the foreword to my book. I also wanted Jack Canfield and Steve Wynn from Wynn Hotels.
Right.
They were my top three. And in my mind, if I crafted the pitch just right and I wrote the foreword that Richard would have written himself or that Jack would have written himself or Steve Wynn, or if I found something personal, a way to reach them, maybe they're feeling good on a certain day and they say, yeah. And I ended up getting a no from Richard Branson, which was a real feat just to get it onto his desk. But he said no. Steve Wynn read the outline. And so I got it to his desk and said no. And Jack Canfield was just so generous. He went and had a look at it and he said, yeah, if the rest of the book is good as this, I'll do it. And he said, yes. You got to do, again, if you're attached to it, as you said, how do you keep going when you don't have the belief? If you're attached to it, very hard to keep going because you're going to be so disappointed when it doesn't. But if you're just, hey, I'm offering. A little kid on his tricycle. You want to get on my tricycle? No? Okay. You want to get on my tricycle? No? Okay. No attachment. Just committed to finding someone to get on the back of that bike.
I love that possibility, like starting from possibility instead of the negative spin of not believing that it's true. So I want to also dive a little bit deeper into the law of numbers because it seems like once you have this huge goal and you don't really believe it's true because you've never made $2.5 million before, you have to then reverse engineer it with a plan, right?
Yeah. So great. Law of large numbers. So let's suppose you've handled possibility. You've seen, yes, it's possible. It could actually happen. And then you've handled your attachment. You make friends with, if it doesn't happen. If it doesn't happen, how am I going to be? Well, I feel proud that I really gave it a good shot. And I like doing this, so I'm going to have fun along the way. Okay, we've handled attachment. Now, often it's about the law of large numbers. With this client today, she might try 7 different offers before one of them gets people's attention. I'm acting now in Los Angeles. Talk about the law of large numbers. You can't do 10 auditions and say, I'm going to be a star. No, if I do 50 or 100 audition tapes,
right?
If I get 2 bookings out of that, I'd say that's pretty good, but I got to do the 100 to get those 2.
Right.
And if you don't have a good time doing the auditions, I decided when I committed to coming out here, I said to myself, David, your stage will be those auditions. That's you acting. If you don't get any gigs at all, you're still going to live the life for a year. And guess what? I've gotten some gigs. Like, it's coming. I'm working tonight. But I made the choice that it didn't have to happen. I want it to happen. I'm playing the game.
Yeah.
But I'm submitting to 150 a week. I'm like bulk submitting. And then when I have the time, I do the audition tapes and upload them, whatever. And every now and then, maybe once every 2 weeks, sometimes once a month, I get a call. Are you available? I look at it and I decide if I want to do it. But you've got to play those large numbers. Byron Katie says you can have anything you want in this life if you're willing to ask 1,000 people.
Yeah, I love that. I remember when I was growing up in New York, I used to joke around with people about certain guys that were have a big at-bat theory. So they feel like if they ask everybody out, somebody will say yes.
Oh, yeah. Oh, my God. You just reminded me of this old story that I haven't told in years. I left my girlfriend alone at a table while I went to the bathroom in a bar. And I came back and this guy is kneeling down next to the table, chatting her up. And I came over and he just kept on talking to her. And then I got curious about like, you're just walking up to everybody here and you don't even care that I'm here. You're just like, see what happens anyway. And he said, you try 10, you get 2.
Yes, that's the law of
life. Swear to God, this guy in a bar, you try 10, you get 2. That guy was a Buddha. He was a guru here to teach us. I'm not saying to everybody you should go to a bar and ask out 10 people, although if you want a date, that's probably not a bad idea. But keep on asking, keep on reaching out. I'm going to reach out to some managers and talent agents to invite them to be on my podcast as a way of building relationships and learning about the industry and networking. And I'll probably reach out to 100 and I might have 2 respond, and that's okay. Then when they respond, I can ask them, who do you know? You know, once I've done the interview with them, who do you know that might be great for this? And then they know this director and they know whatever, and then you keep going. But initially it's just numbers, 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 numbers.
I love that. I hope you single women are taking this in case you see somebody who's that aggressive. You have to think, well, maybe they're that aggressive with everybody. But I love the possibility. I love the detachment. I love the law of large numbers. I have one more question I wanted to ask you about from a personal standpoint, just because I know as an entrepreneur, I need to do less to accomplish more. So can we just talk about the shiny object syndrome and what that is and
We can talk about shiny objects and focus and self-sabotage. They all go in the one bucket for me.
Okay.
So if you're truly committed to something, let's say you're absolutely committed to great health, then out of that commitment, you're probably not going to eat crap. And you will get up when you don't feel like it and go and work out or whatever it is that you've chosen as your path to health. That's what commitment looks like. We self-sabotage. We really do. And one way to self-sabotage, there's so many, my God, perfectionism. Oh, I can't do that. It's not quite right. Bam, 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 yeah. Or I have to understand everything. I understand why did this happen to me or whatever. Or Lone Ranger, I just do it all myself. I do it all myself. Shiny object syndrome is a great way to self-sabotage. Oh, look, squirrel.
Point. That's me. I'm like, look, there's a squirrel.
Yeah. Oh, the human mind is like a monkey on crack. It's crazy. I can sit down, set a timer for 25 minutes, write down the goal that I'm focusing on. And most people never do this, but I can get this focused. And in the middle of it, find that I opened up email because I had to send an email as part of the job. But then I saw an email come in and now I'm responding to it. And I'm like, David, step away from the email. What are you doing? You just said we're going to focus. So if you're committed, you will work out how to focus on what you want and how to put the time in that it requires, because what you focus on, you create, and you will stop the self-sabotage. And this is why coaching is so helpful, because a coach can help you zero in and go, oh, well, why don't you ask for help on that? Or it looks like you're scattered and you're trying to do 10 things and you're not doing any of them well. What if you do 2 or 3 of them really well, and then you do the next 2 or 3? So I've been self-sabotaging recently for quite a while. Since the pandemic, I started smoking weed.
Right.
And it's legal here in California, and it was in Colorado where I was. And I've gotten to enjoy it.
Right.
And And also, I know it's good for the, I believe it's good for the health not to eat after, say, 3 hours before bed.
Right.
I agree. The body can start to shut down. And I don't do that. So my two crutches at the moment are weed and emotional eating. And, you know, you got to ask yourself, what would I be capable of if I didn't do those things? Like, what would be possible if I didn't scatter and I actually focused? What would be possible if I committed to what I really wanted and stopped all the behaviors that don't support that? What would be possible if I took care of my body or whatever it is that you decide that you're committed to? And for some people, the reason they do all this sabotage is because you don't want to find out what would happen.
Yeah,
you don't want to find out your power. Yeah. Or find, maybe you give it everything you've got and then you don't get there, right? Oh, I failed. That's where the non-attachment comes in. If you can be like, I'm going to give it everything and find out. This is why I'm in LA. 1 year minimum, probably going to be 2 years now, to find out what would happen if I really dive into this. That's the game. And after a year, it's good to give yourself a time frame, because you don't want to commit for the rest of your life, maybe, but maybe for 7 days, I will show up as committed. Listeners, if you like this, pick 7 days, say, I'm going to live the life of someone committed to X, and I'm going to write down what that would look like. It would look like doing these things. It would look like devoting this amount of time per day, and I'm going to put that in my calendar. And it would look like not doing these things, not watching those extra 2 hours of TV, maybe not eating that stuff. I'm actually, it's out here. I've got two blocks of chocolate out here, and I'm going to take the ice cream and go and put it down in the lobby of my building, because I'm committing for 30 days to not eat things that have obviously got processed sugar in them. So I'm going to get rid of them. Write that down on a piece of paper and play a game for 7 days. See how it feels after those 7 days to live as someone committed to that thing, ideally not attached to it and yet committed. And then you can roll it on for another 7 days if you like it. If you don't, like, that didn't feel any good, I want to go back to what I was doing.
Well, I love all the topics that we talked about tonight and how you kept circling back to committed versus attachment and just staying the course, keeping focus, not self-sabotaging. Is there anything else that you want to leave our audience with about how to be unstoppable?
Thank you for asking. I want to say none of this is right. I'm not telling you this is the right way to be, that you should be committed and that you should be unattached and that you should not self-sabotage. I'm not saying that. If what you're doing is working for you and you're really happy with your life, then do that. It's just when you realize, oh, I want this thing in my life and or my business and I don't have it, and maybe you're feeling frustrated about it, then sure, grab these tools. This can change your life, change your business, change your life. But I'm not saying you should do it. I'm just saying, if you want more, these are some things I've found for me and my 1,000 clients that I've worked with. Grab it if you like it. But it doesn't make you a good person if you do it or a bad person if you don't. These are simply tools to have your life be better.
Well, thanks for taking us off the hook. And only if you feel there's a gap, follow these tools to success. Where can people find you, David?
Thank you. Well, if I have a lot of free information on my website. You can go to focus.ceo. It's not .com. I managed to get hold of the focus.ceo domain. A lot of that material is free. I send a couple of free videos a week if you want to be in my sphere of influence. I have a podcast you can listen to. And if something sparked you, I'll give you my email address. If I can answer a question for you or help you in any way, you're welcome to email me. Just please don't add me to your mailing lists. That's not cool. I haven't subscribed. But if you want to reach me, it's david@focus.ceo. And if you're interested in coaching, something resonated for you and you're an entrepreneur or business owner and you want to work on not just your business, but also some personal things, because I work on the whole person, then reach out to me through focus.ceo or email. I have a really cool application form because it goes deep and asks some probing questions. It'll have you address, like, what do I really want to get out of coaching or out of my life right now. And it gives me some great info to have a great call with you. And I don't charge for those first calls. They're how I find the right people to work with. So all of that is at focus.ceo.
Well, thanks, David. You've been a fantastic guest.
Oh, my pleasure. Thanks for giving me a chance to talk about life. I told you what lights me up, right? Talking about life. And you gave me all the great questions to let me do it.
Thanks for coming to WholeCEO with Lisa G. After over 20 years helping people lose weight and get fit, I'm so excited to announce that I found the missing link with my coaching. Message me if you want to learn how to look better, feel better, and go faster with a master. Lisa G at lisagfit.com.